All right, here we are then. It's another trash talk. It's not Wednesday, so don't worry, you haven't had a seizure or been abducted by aliens. It is Thursday. We had to move it because my producer, Gareth, who will be floating around the show like an ephemeral disembodied voice, he had to do work or something, which makes him a fucking part-timer in my book. Actually disgusting. Like, how dare you have a job outside of this? I'm really upset with you about that. He's not even got, see, he's not even got anything to say. He's just not
I
talking.
have. The dream is not to have to go to that kind of job. That's the dream. We'll see how that goes.
Hear how angry he is. Fuck, he's fired up. Anyway, so it is Trash Talk. It's the show where we don't bother with any esports guests. We just have little old me. And I got a raging fucking hangover today. I thought it'd be gone by 8 o'clock. Boy, was I wrong. So hopefully you're going to clear the fog on my brain with some great calls. And indeed, it's all about you. We're going to talk about lots of things. I'm going to give you a few guidelines as we do every week. But ultimately, you guys set the agenda. But first and foremost, just a couple of thank yous, a couple of things I do need to say at the start of the show right from the get-go. Thorin Duncan Shields, a journalist you might know, did a long interview with me at Gamescom, which he subsequently posted for episode 71 of his Grilled series. And I don't often get interviewed a lot. I'm generally the person asking the questions. It seems to have been well received. I can never watch my own stuff back. I hate the sound of my own voice. It makes me fucking cringe in half. And yeah, so it's been reasonably well received. If you haven't checked it out and you give a fuck, go find it. It's Grilled. Episode 71, but the main thing is just to say thanks to Duncan for doing it and putting it out there and editing it in such a way that I didn't look like a douchebag. So thanks a lot for him. And as well, I made some off-the-cuff remarks last week, and no, this isn't about the Stefano and the 14-year-old girl thing. I'm not going to apologize for that. But I made a comment about Quantic and their management kind of perhaps being a bit sucker-esque, shall we say, over the whole, Cloud9 thing. And I probably didn't have all of the facts at my disposal. I've done a bit of digging since then and asked around. And, probably was a little bit harsh on Quantic. So sorry, because they're great guys. And, I probably shouldn't have been mean, even though it is trash talk. So I'm just apologizing to Quantic. There's an olive branch. You can take it if you want or not. But anyway, enough of that bullshit. What are we going to be talking about tonight? Well, good fucking question. I don't know what the calls are going to be. But here we go. Talking of Quantic, they've come back to League of Legends. How do you think this new Korean team's going to do? And what do you think about the decision to move that Korean team to Los Angeles? I imagine that's going to be very expensive. Will that be justifiably, spent? Racial stereotyping in online games was something that I wrote an article about this week. Does Lucian really mean that we're finally going to get away from all of the kind of racist stereotypes we see? Think of the Blizzard trolls and that kind of stuff, and certain other MOBA characters, like Rasta, the frog shaman from Dota, and things like that. When are we going to get to a stage where black characters are just regular guys, like black people are in real life? I'd like to get your thoughts on that if anyone out there is interesting. Riot are also advertising for new shoutcasters at the moment, and thought you might have some ideas about that. You might have some suggestions. Maybe you're going in for it. If you are, we'd love to hear from you. Also, does that mean that maybe some of the old guard are getting out? Who knows? Riot have also released another infographic about how flaming makes you lose. And I'm very skeptical about this. I think these statistics are bullshit. I think when you lose, you're more likely to flame. I don't think flaming makes you more likely to lose. I think being shit makes you more likely to lose. And I think these infographics are almost like a marketing ploy from Riot. I think it's their way of addressing how toxic, to use their horrible words that they spam everywhere, how toxic the community is. It's their way of basically dealing with the situation. That's my opinion. Maybe you think I'm an asshole. If you think I'm an asshole, I'd love to hear from you. The LoL World Finals are, of course, looming. Can Europe and North America make a dent on Asia? We all know the answer to that's probably no, but maybe you think differently. We'd love to hear from you if you do. Still no word on the Papa John's promises, which, of course, this relates to StarCraft II. The Papa John's promises, we were told we were going to get show matches and all sorts of wonderful money raining from the sky, and esports was going to become a better place. So far, the only money that's been raining down seems to have gone in the pockets of people like evil geniuses. What do you think about that? I'd love to hear from you if you've got an opinion. Bisu is, of course, retired. He's headed off to military service. Have you got a Bisu-related story? Are you going to miss him? Do you think it was one of these things? Like, was it the right time for him to retire? And, of course, WCS Season 3 is underway. I'd love to get your predictions and thoughts about the season ahead. And, of course, just finally, DreamHack Bucharest is underway. There's several games being played. Obviously, Counter-Strike's one of them. Maybe you're a Counter-Strike person and you want to make some predictions about that. Are NIP going to keep on winning, or are we starting to see the wheels come off a little bit, especially after that kind of awkward NIP versus NIP show game, which was a little bit surreal? But anyway, any opinion is valid. Any game is valid, as long as it pertains to esports, and any call, anything you want to get off your chest is valid. This is a no-holds-barred show. Anyway, Gareth, who have we got first for us, sir?
Okay, so we got a guy called Chris Lewis, and he wanted to talk about the mentality of flaming and things like that. So.
Okay, right, Chris, a fellow Lewis, it's a good surname you've got. So, what's on your mind, Chris?
He is coming from a phone on Skype, so there he is.
Hello?
Here he is. Hey, Chris, how's it going, brother?
Going pretty well. About yourself?
Not too bad. I understand you're at work at the moment. Is that right?
I am, but it's pretty slow, so my manager's okay with it.
That's awesome. What do you do?
Right now, I'm working at Pizza Hut. I'm taking a semester off, but I'm going to be getting a job as a vet tech pretty soon, I think.
Nice, so. Man. Fucking nothing wrong with Pizza Hut. I prefer them to Papa John's, and I think most esports people do at the moment. But anyway, what have you got for me, brother?
Nothing much. It was just, I was reading through the list of the suggested topics to talk about from the post that y'all made on Reddit. And the one that caught my eye was the video that Riot had released about teamwork being like OP and how it's helpful or not. And I just like wanted to share my view on that.
Yes.
And so this is coming from a guy who used to be a pretty toxic rager. I used to be the kind of guy that you would mess up and I would flame you for it. But then I realized that I was losing more games as I did that. So I personally don't think that it's a hoax, I guess, because not just League of Legends, but just about everything in life it's really all psychological. Like, just about everything can be attributed to, like, state of mind, and everything's basically a mind game. But I noticed that, like, after I got banned once for raging, and I was reading through everything that, like, I had said, I mean, that's sort of when I made the change, and I actually ended up, like, going up a fair amount of divisions. I'm actually making it into Diamond like 2 months ago or something like that. And I attribute that not necessarily, I mean, like, I guess I became a better player, obviously, but I feel like the one big part of that is that I really changed my attitude. It's like, you can't go into games with the whole mentality of, I have to take this totally seriously. And if I don't win, I'm just going to freak out and I'm just going to go on tilt. You have to go in games with an open mind, with the mentality that it's okay to lose sometimes.
Yeah.
We're not pros. I mean, well, obviously not all of us are pros. Not all of us can go 150 and 50 and be in Challenger after like 200 games, like a Smurf on a pro or something like that. For us, it's a long, painful process. And when you don't rage, you end up having other people end up being more positive to you, which in turn, it sort of helps you self-analyze a little bit. Because like once you realize that you're raging, you start to think, well, what else am I doing wrong? And then that sort of leads to improving as a player. That's just my experience.
Right, well, I'm going to give you a couple of counterpoints. But the first thing I would like to say is, Chris, you sound like very intelligent young man, and I would argue that it's your intelligence rather than your temperament that has allowed you to be analytical and improve your game. Now, I like to think of myself as intelligent. That might be a goddamn lie, but I've got a fucking filthy temper. Now, I know my level in League of Legends. Like, I know where I'm at. I'm a fucking scrub. That's how it's going to be. I'm never going to be platinum or above. That's just life. You know, I accept it. But I do play the game. And I do get upset when I see certain types of shit, like certain bad things. And I got to say, like, in my, you know, going on anecdotal experience, I've played in games where people have flamed the living shit out of each other and we've gone on to win. And I played in games where we've all been nice and like, hey, let's fucking, you know, all hold hands and fucking, you know, sing tra-la-la-la-la and do a little dance. And we just get fucking rolled, you know, we get 0-20 and it's GG. So on anecdotal evidence, I don't see a correlation between raging and losing the games. I do see a correlation between bad decisions. But what I do want to add is, I think Riot, for all this, like, you know, if they weren't spending so much time focusing on trying to dupe the community, like, oh, if you behave better, you win more games. And I honestly don't believe that you've got a 45% swing or whatever it was in the infographic that went out today. I don't believe you've got a 45% swing of beating a rager. I do not believe it's that big, like, just because you don't rage. And I think they're really over-egging the pudding. What they could do is they could create a much better system that isn't as conducive to rage. Like, for example, the new gold, bronze, silver, the new tiered system, which I think was designed to move away from the stigma attached to the Elo system, that's actually contributed a lot to a lot of the negativity and toxicity because, first of all, if you're bronze, you know, no one's got any time for you. You're a fucking scumbag. You're a subhuman piece of shit. And any view you have about League of Legends is invalid right from the start, which, you know, actually, sometimes that might be a little bit true. Certainly, as someone who worked his way up from bronze, I don't have fond fucking memories of playing the bronze five games at all. But equally, what I will say is, you know, you fall into this situation where, for me, if you've hauled yourself into silver, there should, like, fuck all this hidden MMR bullshit. Like, you should never get put, like, even if you have a bad run, like, it can happen to anybody. I don't think you should be getting put with the same players that you have worked so hard to kind of get away from. And I think that really makes people super angry when it's like, right, I'm playing this game, I've had a bad run, I, like, maybe lost 4 or 5 games in a row, and now I'm getting put with bronze guys, or if you're gold, I'm getting put with silver three guys, and they're just not up to my level, and I'm feeling all this pressure to carry. The other thing I think is with the kind of current Riot model and the Riot mechanics are that basically we've got this system where every game, like, there's just so much fucking importance and individual importance put on you. Like, they pretend it's a team game, yet everywhere you look, Riot are, like, saying, oh, but it's always on you to carry. Like, if you want to get higher up the divisions, you've got to carry. And that's a lot of pressure, a lot of stress to be carrying around on your own individual games, especially when you see someone go maybe 0-4 in a lane and you play mid or jungle, and all of a sudden, not only do you have the pressure to win your lane, you have the pressure to win their lane, and everyone turns around and says, well, if you were good enough, you'd be able to do it. So I think, you know, it's gone. The idea of it being a fun game and, like, just win your lane and blah, 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 the mechanics of the game and what all the pros are saying and what Riot are saying, if you're conscious of that and you actually care, it creates such a super stressful environment just to play in. And even the nicest guy can snap under pressure, or at least that's my take.
I mean, that's extremely true, yeah. So I just want to tackle, like, a couple of things that you said. So first of all, you brought up the issue of, like, you don't see the correlation between, or the hypothesized correlation between positive attitude and winning. But for me, like, when you bring up the point that, oh, I've won games when there are ragers, I've lost games when people are being nice, that absolutely happens. That happens to everybody, and I completely agree with that. And for me, it's not about... When you change something like that, when you change your mentality going into a game, when you have the positive mentality going into a game and say, you know what, it's okay if I lose this game, I'll just move on and go to the next game. To me, it's about averages. That over a long period of time, not necessarily in a short like test sample, but over a long period of time, you'll tend to see that you're winning, I guess, more games. And that's a very hard thing to prove. And I personally, like, I had the exact same opinion that you did right now. But after, like, I had personally changed my, like, my outlook and how I treated other people, thinking that these are other people, I don't want to get flamed. so I might as well not flame them because it just creates more negativity. I ended up seeing myself win more games, and that's one of the things that I attribute it to, but that in my opinion is, like I said before, one of those things that you just have to sort of discover by yourself, I guess.
How do you feel about this sort of almost willing ignorance on the behalf of Riot, that people do react differently to different things? I've always said straight up that the first thing that fixes flaming is you've got a mute button. Anyone who can't tolerate flaming, you know, hit that. That for me is the problem solved. There should never be a need to ban anyone or waste resources on the tribunal or any of that bullshit. If you don't hit mute when someone's flaming you, you are allowing yourself to be flamed in the same way in society. If someone was getting in your face in a pub, well, you know, or a bar or whatever, you know, you've got a choice at that given juncture. You can react back and maybe it leads to a fist fight, or you can be the bigger guy and you can walk away, and that's what the mute button allows. But, you know, for the verbal abuse itself, you wouldn't even dream of pursuing it with the police or whatever. But the thing that I've always said with Riot is they always seem to be so adamant that by being nice to everyone, that's the best way to get the best out of everybody else. And I've done sports coaching, you know, I've coached rugby teams, and I've been a manager in an office, and, you know, had like 60 staff under me. And, you know, you learn about these things, you know, learning styles, and people react completely differently, a different way. Some people need the stick, some people need the carrot, you know, and all the shades of gray in between. And I think, like, you know, personally, if someone calls me a douchebag or says I've done something shit in a game of LOL and solo queue, I think, right, I'm not going to get upset about it, because you kind of know, yeah, that's fair criticism. I'll do it right the next time. It doesn't make me cry. I don't go until it actually spurs me on to be a better player. And Riot completely eschew this possibility. You know, they honestly believe that no one can get motivated from having an almost not quite so friendly kick up the ass.
I mean, my view on that is I feel like, just from what I've experienced, I feel like that is an insanely good quality to have. Is reacting positively to negative, I guess, like negative stimulus. Because I feel like for a large majority of people, generally myself included, is that like when there's a lot of negativity directed at you, you tend to shut down. You tend to just not want to deal with that anymore. You don't play the game as well. And it just sort of puts you in a bad mood. And that's how it is for me. That's how it is for a fair amount of people that I know. Like for example, I was playing in a tournament a couple weekends ago. And we were being just outplayed by the enemy team. And then we had one chance basically to sort of get back in it, which was to have like a dragon fight, which we sort of had the advantage in. But I wasn't necessarily in position. And so my team had engaged in an unfavorable fight. I came to the fight a few seconds late. And inevitably one of my teammates who I played with for a while, he started flaming me incessantly. And I basically said like, look, I'm sorry. I understand that was on me. I apologize for that. Like I owned up to my mistakes, but he just couldn't let it go. And in a situation like that, it's really tough because in like a team game, like in a tournament setting, like you have to have that communication. And if somebody won't shut up and accept the apology and move on, which I feel like is extremely important, then you end up just doing more poorly. I ended up actually leaving the TeamSpeak call because I could just feel myself getting frustrated. So I removed myself from that situation. But then because of that incident, and even like after I said, like I was sorry multiple times, I messed up. I got frustrated. I got negative before I left the call actually. Before I continued to get more negative, I left the call, but
you should have gone Reggie mode. You should have started banging tables and telling people to shut the fuck up. This is an outrage.
Should have smashed the last table like Dyrus, right?
Yeah, exactly, man. Yeah. No, I know what you mean. Look, there's some truth in it. I guess what I'm saying is I think we should be skeptical about, you know, the way Riot are presenting the facts. And here's why. It's the biggest problem facing online games, you know, for is we're all pricks. at the end of the day. We've got a blank slate. I mean, we can behave any way we want, and the consequences are very fucking little. Even if you get banned by tribunal, like, which, again, I honestly don't think that should ever happen, but whatever. If you do get banned, fuck it, I'll create another account, and now I'm going to be twice as bitter, and I'll be all up in your face fucking up your games because, you know, I've got a level up from 0 to 30 again, which is about as much fun as a fucking rectal exam from Freddy Krueger. So, I mean, look, their way of, as I see it, of dealing with the problem is we can't fix the problem. All we can do is try and convince people to fix the problem themselves, and in doing so, they'll get what they want out of it, and what they want out of it is to win more games. So for me, whenever I see these infographics, I think it's almost like an admission by Riot. We can't make people behave. For all the tribunal, for all the shit we've put in place, it's not working. Our community is still toxic. Our community still flames each other. Playing League of Legends and having a bad game can be a very unpleasant experience. And the only way that's ever going to change is if you make it to the utopia of Challenger, when you watch a fucking pro player stream and they're all laughing and joking with each other, even if someone goes like 0 for 10 and it's all fun and dandy, that makes me want to play, and then I have to do gold, silver solo queue, and that makes me sad. Very, very sad.
Well, let me just interject something about that really quick. Is it like permabans don't happen until at least 3 or 4 times of having like time length bans. And I sort of understand what you're saying, but, and I, like I said, I sort of thought the same way previously, but something that like really changed my mind and really opened my eyes to the effectiveness of the tribunal and the like actual effectiveness of what Riot is doing, is there was a TED talk that Riot Lite did. I think it's like 20 minutes long. You could probably find it online somewhere.
I did see that.
Okay. And to me, I thought that was one of the best, like, talks that I've seen in a while, or just, like, one of the best discussions on the issue. And that actually made me like Light a lot. As I thought he presented it very well, and I was sort of on the same impression that I didn't really think it did very much. I thought the tribunal was sort of an issue, but honestly, I think that it's helped a lot. I remember when I first started playing near the end of Season 1, I obviously wasn't very good because I just started playing, but the amount of flaming that I received back then has been exponentially lessened to the level that it is now. I think Riot has done a good job, but obviously you can't force people to act a certain way. The only way that you can, I guess, sort of influence people's behavior is either to show them the negatives of acting a certain way, or the positives of acting a different way.
So, final thoughts then, Chris. In a word, the infographic in particular with the statistics, bullshit or not?
Personally, I don't think so.
Okay,
I think it has a lot of ground.
Look, Chris, I'll let you get back to doing what you're doing. And thanks for calling while you're at work. All the best with the rest of your degree and education and all that. But I hope to hear from you again before that. And thanks a lot. Great, strong first call to open up the show. And enjoy the rest of your shift. Okay, that's him. He's gone. No farewells. Quite sad. But I thought we were bonding. I could have made that.
Probably my fault. I removed him.
Yeah, you just removed me, did you? What an asshole. Fuck me. I know. See, this is what happens when you go away and you actually do a job, another job. You take your fucking eyes off the prize and you fuck things up, Gareth. It's unacceptable. Anyway, I saw a few people saying, ZZZ, that caller was boring. This is motherfucking trash talk. Well, all right. You want to step it up a bit, you know what to do. Add Trash Talk TV to Skype and maybe you can go crazy. Maybe you've got a contrary point of view. Just want to add this in, a couple of bits of breaking things we've had, because obviously we do encourage people to interact, which you can do on my Twitter, which is Richard_A_Lewis, or you can do it using the hashtag TrashTalkHM. And we've had someone say, a guy called Andre Erdman says, I've discovered that the winner of the Euro Hockey League would win 20,000 euros and an LCS winner approximately 25,000 euros. Esports is coming. Well, he's absolutely on the money. I've said it for a long time. The success of esports and the growth of esports is absolutely inevitable. And for anyone who doubts it, you only need to look at the trend. It's definitely going to be a real thing very soon, comparable to other sports. So that was his point. And we've also had the news for you CSGO enthusiasts. You may remember in ESEA, there was a team called Jabri, and they were basically rolling everybody. They were raping face. Well, turns out some of their players just got banned today, and what everyone was saying about them being obvious cheaters was true. So maybe you want to call in and fucking gloat about that if you were one of the players affected. I'd love to hear from you. Anyway, Gareth, who have we got next? What's our next call?
We have got a guy called The Small Guy, and he wanted to talk about giving community members leading roles who tend to be complete idiots.
Interesting. So I know this is Tal Ha. He called in last week. Can you hear me, Tal?
Yes, I can. Hello.
How's it going, brother? You okay?
Yeah, everything's fine. How are you doing?
Not too bad. You said it like Joey Tribbiani, which is kind of worrying. this is just a phone in about esports. I'm not looking to get fucked. All right. Just take it easy with the eyebrows.
It's not that kind of call.
No. We'll go webcam after. I promise. Right, so you want to talk about idiots and esports and community people, and you know what, idiots and esports, it does tend to go hand to hand, so tell me what you got.
I knew you would like this, because I, for the first time, I got absolutely mad at this. I sent you a link, I'm not too sure if you saw the video. It was Broken Shard in his youth days, dancing, you know, to the Akon stuff.
Yeah, I did see that.
We were all talking, should we put it on Reddit? People were like, you know, they're putting it on, they were like, we're just too scared to press the enter button to put it on. But it went on, and it was nearly getting to front page, and it was all happy, it was all fun and games. And it's something that I know you would probably encourage, and I encourage as well, like, for other people to see that these pro players, these people who you see in front of the camera all the time, that they're no different. They do stupid stuff like we do, like dancing like this. And, you know, the thing that really made me mad was the mods of League of Legends said that it had nothing to do with League of Legends, and so they removed it. Now, okay, I don't want to like say, oh, they shouldn't remove this video. It's the fact that they're saying that they know what is League of Legends and what isn't. Because I can guarantee you that if this was Doublelift or anyone else that's in the LCS right now, that wouldn't have been removed. That would have been number one, like, straight away. If it was Doublelift dancing like pissed off the top of his head, that would be number one.
But this is Reddit in a nutshell. I mean, look, right, I don't know what kind of creature you have to be a Reddit admin, and again, I'd love to hear from one, but fuck me, the minute they get their foot in the door with this little bit of internet power, and maybe a Reddit admin
that's
is
exactly for, it.
Yeah, but maybe a Reddit admin is further up the fucking food chain than me, right? Okay, maybe that is true. But it's still a piddling little bit of internet power. The minute they get there, they apply their own nonsensical standards to it. And it's actually subverted what Reddit was meant to be used for. Now, Reddit was meant to be an aggregator for the content that people, you know, relating to the subreddit, that people felt best reflected what the rest of the community would be interested in or deserved applause and praise, and therefore you could upvote it, and in doing so you would make it more likely to be seen by other people. It's a very simple concept, and it's been around for a long time. Reddit took it, ran with it, became the phenomenon that it did. But increasingly in these subreddits you have these ridiculous situations where the admins are upholding standards completely devoid of common sense, completely bereft of any sort of wider reasoning. And you get situations like where Joe Miller, one of the voices of League of Legends, puts a post up saying, hey guys, I'm about to commentate this awesome game. Let's you know, fucking get as many viewers as we can. And that gets deleted and Joe Miller gets banned for self-promotion.
Wow.
Wow, indeed. So,
wow.
It's not even a case of if you're at the top of the sea. it can happen to anybody. These admins have got these guidelines and they are inflexible about it. Now, look, I've been fucking shadow banned and you know, the Cadred staff have, because we're not considered big players. So when we post a bit of content, often it'll get deleted or the staff will do it and they'll get shadow banned and all that shit. So it creates a situation where all we want to do is share. Now, for me, there should be no rule against me putting something up there if I did it, like I do with Trash Talk. I put it up there every week, and then it's up to the community, and I tweet it and say, there's the Reddit thread, and that's it. Now, surely we have enough faith in the community that if the content's bollocks and no one wants to see it, it'll get downvoted into oblivion, or if people are indifferent, it just hovers, or if people like it, it'll get upvoted. That's the premise of the Reddit system. Yet the admins want to step in and tell you how to use Reddit. They want to prevent you using it in a proper way. They want to basically control and influence what content goes to the top. And just to give you another example, because I could rant about Reddit nonstop, I came in, and one of the things I like to do, because I've got a budget where I can go out to people who want to write articles and create videos, and you know this because we've talked about it, and I can say to you, hey, do me a video and I'll give you some money. Now, what a great way for people in esports journalism or in esports in general to get paid. Right, I've got the purse strings, I can share the wealth, and if I see something get to the top of Reddit, there's a whiff them, what's in it for me, and that is, of course, I'll get that sweet, sweet traffic if it goes to the top the next time. So, everyone wins. Now, I come in, and I got this guy who was doing these comedy lol pieces, like fake interviews with champions, that kind of thing, and I was paying him money per article. It would get to the top of Reddit, it would get upvoted, but it would be on our website instead of his blog. Now, someone said, oh, I don't like this nasty corporate Cadred coming in and doing this.
Wow.
And they copy-pasted the article. So there was no need to click on the link to our website anymore. Copy-pasted it, which you can argue is, you know, copyright infringement, because it's copyright material. We paid for it. We haven't given the express permission that it can be replicated anywhere. So I contacted a friendly Reddit admin and said, look, dude, can you just delete that? And he went, oh, it's not my job to protect your content. So it's all, and I was like, nah, you're being an idiot, dude. There's got to be like, is there a grown-up I can talk to? Like, is there a fucking, is there like a real admin, like someone with half a brain that might be able to communicate on a real level? So I got through like the top admin, the super admin, or whatever fucking, you know, faggot titles they
God admin.
Yeah, they fucking give each God other tier. Like these days. Yeah, yeah, God tier admin. So I was talking to the God tier admin, and he upheld it. He said the same shit. And I'm like, this is the same motherfucker that is going to hit delete on content, like exactly what you're talking about. So I don't know. Reddit's a fucking law unto itself. I don't even think you need necessarily apply that to be a community thing. It's just unfortunate that most of the League of Legends community is on that subreddit.
No, it's the fact that they say, oh, it's got nothing to do with League of Legends, when a couple of months ago, I swear to God, Travis had this interview up for Dota 2 on the League of Legends front page. What is that doing on League of Legends?
Travis.
Right? So you say it's got nothing to do with League of Legends, when Broken Shard, TCM, LCS, everything to do with League of Legends, and Travis gets front page for Dota 2. What? Well, the hell is wrong with people?
It's what we always know, and that unfortunately esports is a clique and it's a circle jerk. And as Reddit admins have got more and more power, you know, they definitely have to placate and appease certain people. There's no doubt about that. But equally, I mean, I don't know. I like say the Joe Miller example makes me think maybe it's just random. Maybe it's the luck of the draw. Like maybe some admins genuinely have brain damage, and if you just have the misfortune that one of them notices your post first, and obviously, like, I mean, look, all admins do this. All professions. I mean, I've just called admin a profession. That's pretty lame. but you know what I mean. All groups of people will stick together. Like if someone bans someone on Cadred and they're a staff member, and I know he's kind of done it for personal reasons, I'll say I fully support this decision, even though I know it's bullshit. I'm going to say that because he's my staff. And who do I, you know, who have I got to work with? Who am I going to be asking at 4 a.m. to do a match report on, you know, Cloud9 raping someone? You know, like, it's going to be him. The user will just have to like it. You know, that's, and I imagine Reddit admins are the same. I imagine you've probably got one or two sensible ones. you know, one or two, and the rest are just fucking full-blown, you know, drunk on the smell of their own farts, power-crazed retards. And that's the shit. They have to pitch in with them.
All I'm saying is next time, like, I'm not going to just pick on Travis here, but next time Travis puts up an interview and he doesn't mention League of Legends in it, I'm going to be on it like a car bonnet. I'm going to say this has nothing to do with League of Legends at all. It shouldn't be here. Like, if you get to take something down that we put up because it's fun and games, then this can't get to front page because, you know, someone has to grow a brain. Like,
yeah, but I mean, Travis, like, what's wrong with him anyway? Like, what kind of fuck? Like, is he so unaware about this rivalry that League of Legends and Dota have? Like, did it pass him by?
Oh, good idea. Let me post something about Dota on League of Legends Reddit.
I do not fucking understand it. I mean, you know, a lot of people say this guy, like, fucked his way into the job or whatever, like some sort of insane level of new level of nepotism. I mean, that's the rumor I've heard. God knows if it's true. But I mean, even if, you know, look, I could introduce someone to League of Legends, like, for a day and just say, just go out and Google it. And within 5-10 minutes, they're going to come back and go, wow, Dota 2 people don't like League of Legends, man. They're really butthurt about a bunch of shit. They have got sand in their collective vagina. Like, you wouldn't need to be a fucking genius to find that. So to post a Dota 2 thing in the League of Legends, I'm stupefied. I can't even believe that happened.
Yeah, it was front page. It's like, hey, look, I got together with a caster from Dota 2, and it's front page on League of Legends. Like, all right, that's great, Travis. Good job. Right?
I mean, where does it end? Maybe we should start, like, you know, there's, like, some interesting characters who live down the street from me, like, you know, like just trying to go on it in Birmingham. Maybe I could just interview, like, start just doing interviews with random guys, like, so what do you think about League of Legends? Don't know, live in a council house, you know, like, what the fuck is going on? Like, you know, I can't believe it. So, yeah, idiots, man. I mean, like, it's just one of those things. I saw the video. It, you know, I mean, look, it's not the kind of thing I'd ever advocate. I know why people do that sort of thing. But here's the thing. If you make an ass of yourself and you're willing to poke fun at yourself and you do it for a little bit of PR, a little bit of attention, you know, you've paid the dues because the Jews are making, you know, a knob of yourself, like, to do it for that reason. And I give you another example from StarCraft 2. I remember one of the Intel Extreme Masters, Carmack, and everyone had, he was getting people, he was going around and getting everyone to get up on stage at 9 a.m. and I was like, fuck that, I have a hangover. But to get everyone to do, like, some stupid dance. And that video, that was fine. That was approved. So, and that was on League of Legends and the StarCraft 2 Reddit. No one cried about it. So it just seems to be, like you say, one rule for one and one for the others. But never underestimate the general stupidity of Reddit admins. So, thanks for bringing that to my attention, Talha. Have you got anything else on your mind?
Well, I did read you were talking about the Riot are looking for casters, and I just wanted to give my opinions of who I think it could be. I've been talking to a lot of people, and I think, you know, they'll pick, like, 2 or 3, maybe. I sent my whatever, like, CV on a tissue roll or whatever I sent to them. Like, I have nothing. Like, I'm no name. I'm a no name. But I still sent it to them because, you know, maybe they might like me and be like, all right.
Yeah, everyone wants to work for Riot, brother. Like, fucking course you do.
Let's put him in front of the camera because he likes that. But, you know, I was talking to some people and then I realized, like, oh, wait, I have no chance. Because if you think about the people who could be applying, I think number one could go to Mr. Panky. Like, he's been doing a lot. If he's applied, I don't think they'll turn a blind eye again, like, on him. It'll be like, straight away, Panky, we're probably considering you. Number two would be, actually, I'm probably better than him, but he's in the chat right now, so I'm allowed to trash talk as this is trash talk. It's probably Stress. Like, I have no idea how he's going to get that, but, you know, I mean, I could do a better job than him. I'm pretty sure.
Hey, like, Stress is doing the right thing, man, because not only is he good and he's a good guy, but he's juiced in with fucking Dignitas, and that means you're juiced in with Odie.
That means it's Houston with everyone.
Yeah, I gotta say, like, one of the best quotes I ever heard from a fellow esports enthusiast was, and this was about Odie, and that was, if you did a shit in a pie in front of him, he'd still want a slice of it. And that is, like, just how Odie operates, man. He is one of the smartest motherfuckers in esports. That's, like, a massive compliment, by the way. I hope he doesn't take that the wrong way. But if Stress has got Odie's back in, I mean, I think that might make him a front runner, to be honest.
you know, at I-49, I was really content. I was like, I'm going to go up to Oni. I'm going to say hi to him. But he's a big guy, and I'm pretty small, so I was pretty scared. You know, he's just the kind of guy where if you, like, I've heard that he's really nice, apparently. Yeah. But I was just too scared to approach. I'm pretty sure he saw me as well. But next time, if he's watching Odie, I'll come and say hi to you, I promise. I'll say hi to you.
I'm sure he'll be looking forward to it, Tal. But yeah, so I don't know. But what I will say, just to round this call off, Panky, for me, great guy, been a community stalwart for so long. If Riot wanted to go some way to show that they're still tapped into the community and they're not going to outgrow us, you know, the best thing they could do would be give that guy a job, because that guy has
been working tirelessly for so fucking long.
And, like, you know, I maybe there's been this little thing where perhaps he's thought Riot were going to give him the tap on the shoulder, but for me, absolutely, he should be. He'd improve a lot of the, you know, kind of casting dynamic they have in Europe as well. So I think he'd be a real good addition, and I think Riot should just fuck the application process. They should just get him in straight away.
Yeah. Anyways, thank you. Thank you a lot.
No. It's always good to hear from you, Tal. Hopefully I'll hear from you next week. You take care. I'll let you get back to looking at videos of wannabe boy band LOL players and fucking...
Don't worry. We have a video chat later, so be prepared.
Oh, yeah. And of course, I'll meet you afterwards for some man boob licking on cam. Whatever gets you off, brother. Anyway, I'll catch you later, yeah?
Bye-bye.
Peace. Guys, there you go, Talhar, and the phenomenon of the fucking Reddit admin idiot, which I'm sure we've all been victim of at some point. Maybe you're a Reddit admin and you would like to defend yourself, because you really got some defending to do, I think. I'd be interested to hear about it. So if you're a Reddit admin, a Reddit moderator, add Trash Talk TV to Skype, and let's see if you're as much of a cretin on air as you certainly appear in your moderation decisions in your subreddit. Right, what we're going to do is quickly, because I've just noticed the time. Fuck me, there were two long calls. I apologize. I'll start being harsh with the rest of the bums that phone in. We're going to take a quick break and do some hydration. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in just a few minutes. And he's just said one. That's the end of the countdown. So we're back after our little break. I'm just getting rehydrated, trying to kick this hangover out of my body. It's not going too well, but you callers are helping. You're all helping. I feel like this is almost like being in an AA meeting, and you guys are helping me through the difficult time. So thanks very much for that. And thanks very much for all the callers and the people we got queued up. Just before we go with that, I did notice there was a comment in our Reddit thread on League of Legends. Some guy seems to have missed the point of what, or maybe he's understands the point of what the show is. Rather than just say, oh, I look forward to tuning in or anything like that, he just did the following post. Okay, here I go, trash talk. Dyrus looks like an overweight basement dweller who hasn't seen sunlight for 400 years. Alex Itch is a massive virgin. Darian from Gambit Gaming is really sexy. I wish he would go swimming with me or maybe play golf. After our intense golf game, he kisses me on the neck and I blush. That's made it all worthwhile. Like, I don't know if we're ever going to top that as a comment. Like, fuck me. I'm trying not to crease. That is. If you are the guy who made that comment, please call in. Please just fucking call in. Anyway, we've got a caller. It's Saul Cooper. Saul Cooper, and he wants to talk about some Tribunal stuff in League of Legends. So we're going to bring him in now. Can you hear me, Mr. Cooper?
There we go. Hold on 1 second.
It's all right, man. How you doing? You okay?
Yeah. Let me just turn off the sound on the stream so I don't actually hear myself talk, because that'd just be awful.
Oh, yeah. I hear that.
There we go.
So I see, right, he told me, like, Sal Cooper. Like, I was thinking, like, oh, he's Mr. Sal Cooper, but no, he just says Sal Cooper.
I said Sal Cooper, you just didn't listen to me properly.
It's pretty hard, yeah.
Yeah, well, fuck it anyway. So thanks for calling in, brother, and you've got some Tribunal shit on your mind.
You talked about how before you don't really think that we should have the Tribunal and things like that, and the one thing, now for the trash talk, I kind of agree with you on that. Like, if, you know, you just kind of need to sack up if someone yells at you and just either mute them or, you know, deal with it. But there are definitely a lot of good reasons for the Tribunal, like mainly like someone's being toxic, as in intentionally feeding, disconnecting, or just like overall just, you know, intentionally trying to ruin someone's game. As far as like raging and things, I don't think that's, you know, the Tribunal issue, but there's certainly some Tribunal aspects that means it needs to be kept.
No, I do agree with you on that front, and I would say, like, there has to be something in place for you know, intentional feeders, and certainly people who go AFK. But what I've never understood is why League of Legends can't implement a system similar to Dota 2, where it's like, if somebody leaves, it's like, if you play on and manage to get a win, you get a reward. But if you just decide to leave and don't waste your time, you don't lose anything from that game because somebody left. Like, all of the punishment goes on to them. And if it happens very often, they get put into a special kind of, well, a non-prioritized queue, but they also get put with other leavers. So, you know, they end up in almost like a sort of Dante's Inferno situation where everyone they play with is as big a douchebag as they are. Right. I'd love to see something like that in League of Legends. Like, I think, again, one of the most terrible things, like one of the things that induces a lot of flame, is that if someone's AFK for a while, you immediately think, well, fuck it, I'm going to lose and it's going to cost me LP, or this is my promotion series and we got to play 4v5. So, you know, I definitely think, rather than just ban them or have that almost powerless feeling of a report where you never even know what happens afterwards, there should be a system in place where you don't get penalized. You know, they still get the rewards for winning, but you don't lose anything for losing.
The only thing with that is I can just see, like, there's pretty easy to abuse, especially with the dual queue system. Just like, oh, you're doing bad? Like, just queue up with your buddy. If you start losing, just, you know, he can just quit because he's on a Smurf account or something. He doesn't care. And then, you know, then you don't lose anything, and it's a easy climb.
True.
So, I mean, I don't know if there's a perfect situation for that. I definitely see both aspects of it. The other thing I did want to mention, too, is just you talked, you know, as far as the that infograph or whatever that thing was. Now, I can say, just as one aspect is, I don't know if they're saying necessarily, like, by not raging at your teammates, like, oh, they'll cause them to win more, because that's, you know, definitely one of those motivation things. I, you know, when I played hockey, my coach yelled and raged at me all the time and made me play better. But I think what they're trying to go for more is they're saying that if you're focusing on raging and yelling at your teammates, then that's effort that's not being used towards like focusing on the game. Now, I personally would be probably considered the nice guy that you talked about before, where you know you play well most of the time, but then sometimes you just get frustrated and you just rage on someone. And I think a lot of that ends up when I'm raging on someone, I'm certainly not playing better. I could even say I'm playing worse most of those times. But I think the main aspect of it is when you're raging, you're not focusing on the win. And when you're not focusing on the win, then obviously you're not going to win as often. So I think, you know, maybe I think they definitely exaggerated the infograph a little bit, but there is something to be said about not being it. Like the fact that you're not playing to win because you're focused on raging, like, has some merit when, and you know, it might just be more beneficial to say, like, don't rage on your teammates, go lift weights or something.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, yeah, you know, I think these infographics, I get why they do them. You know, I as I say, I understand it. And it's not as if it's a bad lie. It's a white lie, you know, because if we were to all behave like that, you wouldn't win any more games, I don't think, or maybe you might have a slight increase, but it would actually make the experience of playing a whole lot more fun. You know, if but again, Riot have created this tiered system where every game feels like there's so much riding on it. And the way that the new sort of, you know, by having the MMR hidden and this LP system in place, and the way that you can actually get to a situation where you're only gaining 4 LP for a win, but if you lose a game, you lose 26. If your MMR is so skewed. Yeah, exactly. The MMR is so skewed. They create a situation that's so fucking stressful and feels like hell on earth. Like when it's when what you see is this, like you say, the impossible climb. You know, what you see is the impossible climb. But actually, behind the scenes, your MMR is going up if you just win more games than you lose. But because of the league points, the LP, in front of you, you're like, fuck, you know, 4 points for a win, I won 4 games, I've lost 1, and now I'm back to 0. But if you keep doing that, you're going to go up a division. You're going to start earning more points. But they've created this system that almost dupes people into feeling really fucking, you know, stressed out every game. And that's why I think we can't have this wonderful utopia like what we see on the pro player streams, where everyone's like chilled and winning and losing doesn't really matter. It is just about the experience.
You know, I think there's like two good solutions to that. One of them would be to, if you were to have like a StarCraft method where you don't get points, like you just get promoted at like random times, you can keep the exact same system there. Yeah. But you wouldn't see like your ups and downs. So I think that extra information is causing people stress because they're trying to create a pattern, and when the pattern looks to be against them, then they get frustrated. And then I think the other part to that would be, instead of having, like, when you look at your league, like your league standings, it says like your total wins, your total your total losses are on your own thing. But instead they should have where you say, like, it shows you how many wins and losses you have in that division. So if you do drop down quite a bit, you say, why am I not climbing so like at all? You can look and you say, oh, that's because I've lost 20 games in this division and I've only won 10. And then that would kind of give them a better them better reference.
And I think they hid the losses because they didn't want people to get uptight about it. You know,
they could even have it personally too, you know what I mean? Like, you, instead of showing it, you could just have everyone see, like, you could just see it so you could see how you've done in this division so far. Because, I mean, you know, I was in Diamond 5 for a good couple months. I couldn't tell you what my record was at Diamond 5, but, you know, it says I have 600 games or more. And it's like, you know, but if I knew, like, oh, like, I have, you know, like, I have this many wins in it and I can know how many losses I have in it, like, personally, then it gives me a better idea of whether I should expect to climb. Obviously, if you're down, like, you know, 20, if you have 20 more losses than you do wins, you're not personally going to expect to climb 20 LP a game. You know what I mean?
This is nothing to do with what you're talking about, but it's just to give you an illustration of, like, how at, like, 30, I should probably fucking know better. But I've become the ultimate douche because of the tribunal system. What I do is I'll just generally say nothing in game. Like, or something fairly innocuous. And then what I do is I add the person I want to flame afterwards, and then I let fucking rip with the most vile fucking abuse I can think of.
If they add you though, that's kind of, you know. What do they expect? You go 0-10, and then all of a sudden, like, what is he gonna, you know, like offering advice or I don't know. Like, I personally, a lot of games, I just like, if I'm not in the mood, like, I will just ignore everyone, and I don't want to deal with it. I don't want them to hear, like, see what I write either. So I just try not to write anything. And then, like, I think the main thing, we need to, honestly, like, a lot of this, we need to get these, like, fucking nerds, and myself included, just, like, go lift some weights. Like, you're going to feel so much better. You're not going to rage so much if you actually, like, got some exercise, you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, man, honestly, I can identify with it. I got a fucking beer gut, man. Like, it's just fucking, you know, why don't I go and work out? Why don't I expend that energy? Like, right. I got a fucking exercise bike and some weights in the living room.
After you do it, too, you feel so much better.
Yeah, I could go and do that, but fuck it, then I just think, like,
it's a fucking game.
Yeah, if I play one more game, or, like, if I add this guy and just call him an asshole. And the best thing is, like, it's the best feeling as well. Like, this is so bad, but I'll just fucking say it. Why not? Like, I add them, and then I'll generally lure them in with, like, oh, man, I just wanted to apologize for that last game. Okay. And then I go, yeah, like, oh, actually, that's what you should be typing to me, you fucking douche, blah, blah, blah. And then I just unload it. Like, you lure them in, like, oh, hey, not everyone in League of Legends is an asshole. And then, bang, you show them that you're the biggest asshole, like, you're the ultimate asshole. So, yeah, League of Legends, man, it's a fucked up thing. Anyway, look, I really appreciate your call. Good luck with the climb of Diamond and eventually Challenger, I'm sure. You seem like a level-headed guy. And a great, great message to everyone. Don't get mad. Lift some weights, nerds.
Yeah, thanks for having me, man.
And thanks for calling in. Hope you're calling again. Love you, brother. Take care. All right, then. So there you go. Fucking, in a nutshell, stop being fucking nerds. Get hench. And then you won't give a fuck about a game because you'll be taking out your steroid-addled anger on real people in real life. I like it. It's let's get aggressive. Let's be hostile to people. Gareth, haven't we got another caller?
Yes, we have. His name is Jack Killian, and he wants to talk about people speaking about Hearthstone as if it's going to be the next new eSport. And he thinks people are getting ahead of themselves and stuff, so...
Right, Jack, I remember you from last week, brother. I loved your last call. And this sounds like, again, you've got something to get off your chest. You've got a big rant coming. I'm really looking forward to it. So Hearthstone, man, everyone's been offering... It's like a fucking scene from Menace to Society because everyone's been offering to suck my dick for a beta key.
Fucking hell.
Yeah, no
shit. You're right.
Yeah, I'm good. If you only caught the back end of that, just to get a bad time to come in. But yeah, what I was saying was, man, everyone's been really going over the top to get a beta key for this game. And, you know, on the one hand, yeah, it's a Blizzard game, so you think it's going to be cool. On the other hand, it just looks like a poor man's Magic the Gathering. So what are your thoughts?
Well, at first when Blizzard announced the game, I was a bit disappointed. I thought, oh, fucking card game, you know, didn't really give a shit about it, to be totally honest. And then the beta came out and I caught a few people streaming it and I thought, I'll check it out just to see what it's like. And it, you know, at first I was like, it actually doesn't look too bad. It looks like a bit of fun and stuff, you know. And especially I've been told it's going to be put on like iPad and stuff when it's released. So I thought, yeah, you know, I can see it doing okay. It might be a fun little game to pass the time. But everyone's all of a sudden giving it, oh yeah, it's going to be a new big eSport. It's going to take out StarCraft 2. It's going to be Blizzard's main eSport. I'm like, hold up a second, mate. Calm down. What are you on about? This is not going to be an eSport game. Like, I don't know if you've seen, but Artosis has already made a new show dedicated to it, talking about discussion and strategy for the game. And I'm like, why is everyone getting so mad about a game which is fundamentally, yeah, as you said, a poor man's Magic the Gathering?
I'm just going to do this. Right, and if you look into the webcam, you'll see what I'm talking about. Obviously, he's doing that. I mean, that's a money thing. I mean, like, seriously.
Oh, yeah.
Because Blizzard are going to, you know, fucking... They are going to push it hard. I got no doubt about it. And, you know, I can... It's really fucking weird. You know how, like, in Hollywood, there'll be, like, one film come out, like, The Prestige, right? Like, you know, about magicians. And at the same time, a film with fucking Ed Norton in it called The Illusionist, right? And then I'd know... Like Titanic and The Boat That Sank. I mean, that's not a real film, but you know, you get the point. Films seem to come out in clusters, like everyone's got one idea at a time. And collectible card games, they're coming back, man. Like, online collectible card games is like the big thing at the moment. It's going to be the new MOBA. Everyone's going to have one. Mojang set up Scrolls, which, again, I got invited to the beta of that. I remember, you know, Total Biscuit was straight in there doing videos for that game. And it's really weird. Like, everyone seems to be trying to make one. Warhammer 40K, that license is gone. There's going to be a collectible card game based around that. I think it's going to be available through Steam. I saw another thing on Greenlight whose name escapes me. And guess what? It's a fucking collectible card game. And it's great because obviously it's about microtransactions. And if you've got to buy cards, you know, to have better decks, which is what Magic the Gathering predicated their actual success on. And Magic the Gathering is brilliant. Esports could learn a lot from what Wizards of the Coast did with Magic the Gathering, especially their Pro Tour. But, you know, if you have to pay money to be better at stuff, but it's okay, it's not really pay to win, because fuck it, man, you could technically still unlock that card if you were willing to, you know, play 1,000 games. Or you might just get lucky and get it dropped once. It's the perfect excuse for microtransactions.
I do agree. But it's just, I'm of the opinion that, like, I can't, people saying it's going to be like an esport, like, I, as a spectator, it's not a fun game to watch. Like, when I was watching people stream it, I wasn't, you know, I thought if I was in their shoes playing it, with, you know, sitting around lounging with one hand on my mouse, clicking on a card and then put it down and just, you know, boggling my mind, trying to not really think about anything but the cards. Yeah, it's probably a bit of fun way to pass the time. But a spectator sport, can you imagine, like, a stream of like 50,000 people watching this and people casting the game? Oh, and he's now got the fucking magic Murloc card that's drawn, and oh, it's just bad luck. The one fucking card in his deck that could beat his entire other deck is fucking drawn. I just can't.
I'm sure it's gonna happen. I mean, like, here's the thing. Like, back when I first started esports journalism, I'd actually looked at Magic the Gathering, and obviously this was before the advent of streaming and that sort of thing. But, you know, when you saw like film of these people watching the tournaments, like, they had a specific setup, which was to have a camera, obviously, like, almost like poker, you know, it was top-down, bird's eye, looking on the table, and you could see the cards, and they would play on, like, glass tables again, so you could see what cards they had in their fucking, you know, in their hand, and what was he going to play, and people sat there watching these two dudes play cards, and they were going wild for it, like, absolutely wild, like, oh my god, he's just played Skeleton Man, that's shit. It's the shittest name for a card ever. He's just played Skeleton Man, and Skeleton Man's gonna, you know, he's a 2-for-2 black creature, and people are like, yeah, woo, we're partying now. Like, I don't fucking understand it, man, but the beautiful thing about being a nerd is it doesn't make sense. And if you don't give a shit about it, you just see a room full of idiots. You just see a room full of losers. But if you give a fuck, if it touches you, you know, then it does make sense. And I think Hearthstone, for right or wrong, it's going to get a big push. And maybe all of those people who, you know, kind of fell out of love with Magic the Gathering by the, like, millionth expansion pack, or people who've never played an online collectible card game before, they could get into it, man. And you know, again, like, think about all the kids who were playing Pokemon trading cards and the Pokemon card game. And they've grown up a little bit now, and you can't get away with liking Pokemon anymore, but maybe Hearthstone's okay. So it's got a chance, Jack. It has got a chance.
I don't have anything against it as a game. Like I said, I'm sure it's going to be a fun game to play. I'm probably going to play it when it comes out. Mm. If I got given a beta key for it, I'd probably give it a go. Mm-hmm. But what frustrates me is the amount of keyboard warriors I'm seeing on Twitter and commenting on Artosis's bloody new show, saying this is going to be the biggest thing since fucking sliced bread.
Yeah, but again, okay, now what we're getting into, Jack, is self-interest, another esports staple, right? If you're a commentator, and especially if you're involved in StarCraft 2 right now, your ass is tight. You do not know when it's all going to come crashing down. You don't know when your next paycheck's going to come about. Like, all the people who, like, publicly are saying StarCraft 2 ain't going to die. Believe me, privately, they're going, oh my God, I think it's going to die. Like, what the fuck? Like, no one saw that coming. No one saw StarCraft 2 struggling by this stage in its development. The third expansion isn't even out now. This was a game that when people came into it, and all of the people who come into it did so for fucking money for the most part. There are people out there, You know, like, you know, guys like Artosis and, you know, Tasis and guys like that, you know, who I believe love StarCraft, but there were plenty of bottom feeders. Okay, well, all right. Yeah, but, you know, there were plenty of bottom feeders who got in because they were like, this is 10 years of esports money, wicked. And all I got to do is pretend I used to watch a bit of Brood War. That's it, right? I mean, that was all you needed to get in. So, yeah, right? Like, people think it was going to last forever, and it's not. People are really worried right now. You know, I've talked to casters, like StarCraft 2 casters and StarCraft 2 personalities privately, and a lot of them are thinking, what's the next game? Like, and where do I leap? And in order to have opportunities, you know, you need to, you know, promote other games. Now, let's say you were a StarCraft 2 caster and all of a sudden you started sucking on the Dota dick, then obviously Blizzard are going to be well pissed off at you because you're effectively promoting a competitor in the form of Valve. If you start, you know, blowing Hearthstone very publicly, Blizzard is still all right with you. You're not burning any bridges because, after all, it's going to make Blizzard money. You know, so this is what I'm talking about. Like, people in esports and the self-interest that they go through, they'll tell the community out there that it's going to be amazing. They'll tell them that it's going to be big and look at all these players, and they'll massage the figures and they'll massage the numbers. And that'll get them paid a bunch of times right at the start. But if the game doesn't take off, they look at it like, well, no one's really lost anything, you know? And they can go back to, you know, to the game they were at before, or they'll go back to, or they'll go something new. And that's how it works. So that's exactly what goes on in esports. And people have done it a million times. I mean, think of games that we've been told are going to be big.
Fucking, when fucking... Shoot Mania came out and everybody was saying it was going to be the next big FPS game.
Prime example, right? Shoot fucking Mania. What the fuck? you know, serious. Like, guys. And the people are still out there now, like, saying, yeah, this is still an esport. This is still a game. It's going to be huge. It's not ready yet. You know, just give it time. Fuck off, dude.
I mean, Brink as well.
Yeah, Brink, you know, these games were dead as fucking Dillinger from the moment they fucking pretty much launched. It was just, what I hate about what, like, and I said this in the Thorin interview I mentioned at the start, what I hate now is the way esports has been subverted into becoming this quick fix cash cow for game developers. And they're only interested in supporting it if it gets a community. It's like chucking shit at a wall and, you know, some of it's going to stick. So we'll make this game in this genre and we'll make an FPS and we'll make an MMO and we'll make a collectible card game. And if we do that, one of these games is going to get a community of 50,000 people that we can nurture and grow and make it 100,000, 150,000. And no one in a games developer is doing this. No games developers are doing this because they want to have communities. They want us to have a good time. They want us to, you know, play games and feel like it matters somehow. They're doing it to make fucking money. And, you know, a lot of these games will be, you know, here today, gone tomorrow, bullshit.
Your camera's going to fritch.
Oh, my God. Look at that. Yeah. Did I spit on the fucking lens? Have I done that? Like, it was fucking... There you go. Wicked.
I think you hit on the head on your... I watched your grilled with Thorin and... Basically, what you just said then is what you said in your grill, where you're like, you hate how fucking corporate esports has become in terms of like the developers making the games just for the fun, just to make the fucking money and get, you know, get shit out of it, as opposed to making the game because players really love the game and want to play the game.
I see someone in the chat's quickly mentioned Reborn. It's a tough one for me because I like James. And I've got a lot of time for him and we talk, and maybe in the future, my potential esports career could be in his hands. Who knows? But what I will say is, I don't know if Reborn is about, I don't think it's an altruistic project. I think James wants to get paid, you know, and he's looking at ways to do that. Like Day 9 going off to make a game. Mr. I love StarCraft 2 so much, I'm going to make a game in the same genre as it. Like, how the fuck does that work? You know? I just think it's like, people in esports realize that esports isn't forever unless you really love it and you really give a fuck. And you know, and it's, you've got a limit on how much you can get out of it. And I think people just look at, like, ways to get paid, do this, do that, do this, do that, and then get the fuck out. And I think when people start talking about making their own game, that's pretty much like exit plan. Because if it's successful, you'll never have to do any of the cringeworthy shit that you used to do. You'll never have to commentate, no matter how much you profess to enjoy it. You'll never have to do it. You'll never have to do that 14-hour day. The only time you'll be on camera again will be promoting your new fucking game. And then you'll just sit back and let the royalties come in. But, you know, whether that'll happen for Dana, whether that'll happen for James, I don't know. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I got those guys all wrong, brother. I don't know. But I definitely see it as a means to get money and not a lot else. And I think I've yet to see an esports game made by people who I believe have a genuine understanding of what esports should be about. Because the people who embody esports for me, they couldn't sit down and get money. They couldn't. They're the same sort of fucking nerds that we've just been laughing about. They couldn't go to a big sponsor or developer and get money out of them. They wouldn't know how. They probably don't even own a suit. I bet they got a Chewbacca costume, you know, but they haven't got a fucking smart suit, you know. So that's in my experience anyway. So Jack, great call. I'll give you the last word on this call though. So Hearthstone, what are your final thoughts about it?
Hearthstone, fun iPad game. Don't try and think it's going to be a fucking like League of Legends killing esport hero. That's basically my thought. Yeah, I don't have any, you know, I think it's going to be a fun game. If people like the game, that's fair enough. If you enjoy, you know, playing the game on a competitive level, that's fair enough. But don't try and start professing that it's going to be this big next fucking thing, because I don't think it's going to be quite as big as some people are expecting it's going to be.
All right. Okay. Well, Jack, thanks for calling in again. Hope to hear from you next week. Take care, brother.
Cheers, mate. See you next week.
Will do. All the best. Right. And are the people out there, right, saying, do you honestly think I'm wearing this Rock Hat t-shirt because Rock Hat have paid me to
wear it? I was going to say that.
Does anyone think that? Or is it that I woke up with a hangover, I was feeling rotten, and I didn't even put on clothes until about 5 minutes before this show? And because I'm an esports journalist and I get loads of free shit, the one thing I'm always going to have clean in my chest of drawers over there is a gaming t-shirt.
Thank God you remember to actually put the t-shirt on. Like, that could have been unfortunate.
Well, yeah, exactly. No one would say that. I mean, serious, guys. This is me. This is Richard Lewis. I've got integrity. You know? Like, it's a coincidence. Rocket aren't fucking paying me at all. If they want to, we'll talk, right? Because for all the integrity, it'd be nice to get fucking paid. But that dirty esports money. But come on, guys. Like, fucking guys. Can't even believe it. What a terrible accusation that is. Anyway, Gareth, get me another caller.
All right. We will have, I'm just going to find him now, but it will be Kurt, also known as Key Hunt.
So, yes. What does he want to talk about? Because I love this guy.
He wants to talk about multiple things based on the last call, as well as Azubu TV and the Quantic LOL announcement.
He's always
fucking
so
talk
smart.
About everything. Just lay it all out.
It's my man, Kurt. I fucking love it, brother.
Richard, here's the thing. If Rock Hat wanted to sponsor you, I have a feeling it would not be for this show. They're like, look, every show but Trash Talk, where it's just pure talking shit for 24 hours.
No one would want a fucking sponsor Trash Talk. We could not sell this idea to anyone. But that just said, can I just pop you on hold a minute, Kurt, while I just say this next call is brought to you by Rock Hat. Set the rules. Okay, buy their mice. Right, so what have you got for me, Kurt? Lots of shit on your mind, I'm sure.
First I want to talk a little bit about the last caller and Hearthstone. Like, I understand his, like, constant dismay. It's like, no, not a trading card game. But I think to think that it's not going to be an eSport is a little ignorant, like, possibly. Okay. I mean, you're talking about a game that is free to play. It's not going to cost anybody anything. It's going to be available on the iPad. It's going to probably be available maybe on Android, maybe even. It'll be available on PC. The stream numbers already for the beta are pretty big. I mean, I think they're going to put a lot into it to making it an eSport. I mean, a bunch of coworkers I work with and things like that, they're fucking playing it 24 hours a day, got like 800 games played. And I'm on Skype with him doing work, and he's like, God, fuck, you know, you know, 15 damage, bullshit, you know, like,
I don't know how anyone could get fucking fired up about Hearthstone. Like, I've got the beat, I played it, man, like, I haven't even got past the fucking mage shit, yeah, I'm just like,
what,
yeah,
a bullshit level draw, I hear it all the time, man, I hear it. So, like, I think it's definitely going to be an esport, and a pretty big one at that. It's not necessarily something I enjoy watching, but a lot of people apparently do. I mean, shit, I mean, people enjoy watching Magic the Gathering, like, the actual card game. Like, I mean, yeah, like you said, you mentioned the Wizard of the Coast Pro Tour. I mean, that's pretty, you know, interesting.
Is it the StarCraft II killer, Kurt? I mean, people are saying that because apparently Blizzard have intimated it's going to be their focus now.
I hate that bullshit that, like, anything kills another game. It's kind of like, well, you know, Idre is going to move on from an RTS game to a trading card game, or, you know, like
he might have a chance of winning something if he does that.
That'll at least make it interesting.
But maybe not. I can just imagine him raging and tilting just like he did for most of his StarCraft career. Like, but anyway.
Yeah, I just don't. I don't see players moving over. I don't really see viewers going. You know, the casual players going, "Hey, like, fuck StarCraft. I'm gonna go play a trading card game." Like, the game's. I don't think it's gonna kill another game, especially a game like League of Legends. I mean, a game that's on its proverbial dying leg, maybe. You know, but I don't see it killing StarCraft II or League of Legends, especially with another expansion still to come out. I mean, Blizzard's not just going to stop everything. It's like, we're going to put everything into this free-to-play game, this Hearthstone trading card game, because fuck Legacy of the Void.
Like, yeah, but I wonder if they're going to maybe do it a little bit like Valve, where it's just going to be like some Half-Life 3 bullshit or something, where it's like the third expansion's just going to be like, fuck, we're just going to save that for a rainy day. We're going to try and, you know, bleed these esports scumbags with these other shiny baubles, and then we'll come back and release the, you know, third expansion when you know, it's going to be pretty much just viewed as a standalone way for us to make money, and it closes off the StarCraft story.
Yeah, I mean, and I also think they're not necessarily pointing to the StarCraft II audience for Hearthstone as much as they're pointing towards the World of Warcraft audience. I mean, are there any units in Hearthstone that are in StarCraft? Like, I know that, like, they pulled a bunch of World of Warcraft references in Hearthstone, but nothing from StarCraft yet, from my understanding. I think
because it's Hearthstone and it's like Legends of Warcraft or something is like the tagline for it, you're probably not going to see any sort of StarCraft II stuff. But what's interesting is, with any sort of card game, like, you can do these sort of themed expansions, and I imagine that if they wanted to, they could bring out, like, you know, a fucking StarCraft edition that would get all the fucking StarCraft nerds hard, and they'd be like, oh, well, I wasn't going to play Hearthstone because it was orcs and elves, and that's really nerdy, but now that it's Zerg and Protoss, it's cool, you know?
Yeah, it's like Warcraft, but StarCraft, we're good.
Yeah, exactly. So, I think, put it this way, it's going to be somewhat, I don't think it's going to be like a long-standing esport. Like, I don't think if Trash Talk runs for another 100 episodes, all right, let's say 400 episodes, I don't think on episode 400 we're going to be talking about, you know, fucking who just won the Hearthstone Invitational and got like $2 million or whatever. I think what's more likely is it will be a very significant flash in the pan, and there'll be a lot of money thrown at it, and it will be a successful game. But I don't think it'll have that same sort of longevity as something like, you know, Brood War or whatever. So that's my take.
Yeah, I think that's probably right. Moving on, I guess. I wanted to talk a little bit about Chronic LOL because I know that was in the suggestion, and I think that's probably the biggest news released over the past couple of days, I would guess.
Yeah, it's been a slow week, but you know, I'm like I say, I felt bad. I think it was our call last week where I made the comments about Quantic being a bit suckery in how they'd handled it all, and maybe they, you know, had been a bit amateurish. And since then, obviously, you know, like I say, done a bit of digging and been told that, you know, there's a bit more to it all than meets the eye, but that's all being kept behind closed doors for obvious reasons.
I think I know most of it, and I think Quantic is a little bit to blame, just like everyone else. Like, don't get me wrong. I mean, I don't think they were completely void of fault by any means in the way things were handled with their last team. So, I mean, I don't think you have anything to apologize for. Everyone could use a little, you know, ass kicking every once in a while, you know. But But what I do think, I think this is a pretty damn good move for them if it works out.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a pretty large investment. I don't know some of the back-end stuff, like where this team's going to be living more permanently. If it's like their old team, they'll be living with Fuji, the manager, one of the managers of the team. Could be completely different. They might be having their own house. They might be investing more into that. I don't know. I've read as much into that as I probably should, but if it's like their old team, they're living with another manager. Like, I just don't know how the team's gonna like that. I mean, this is a team. This is a, you know, a bunch of Korean players, but Loco Doku was on CLG. He was in a pretty large house by himself with like six players and like three girlfriends, and everything was good. You know, like so I don't know. I don't know how that's gonna work out.
I think it's great. I'll tell you why. Because talk about ruthless thinking. We've done, you know, four of these shows. Obviously, I've done lots of shows. It comes up all the time on Climbing the Ladder, on Chan Man Show. You know, it comes up on the Esports Heaven Show. Always comes up. We talk about Koreans, you know, just beating people, especially in North America, you know. And we talked about, you know, there should be region locking in WCS. And I think with all of this sort of environment that's going on, what Quantic have actually done is, like, we got fucking jacked and literally jacked. For the fucking, you know, having the best team that went on to fucking win the North American LCS. Now, to get an American team to try and compete with that, well, we've seen Cloud9 are fucking streets ahead of everybody, and it's going to take a lot more than a seasonal split to catch up. What can we do? Fuck it. Koreans. The answer to life's problems. Koreans. Need to be successful in an esport? Hire a Korean. End of fucking story. And they've gone out and they've got a Korean team. I wouldn't say it's necessarily the most amazing Korean team, but it's a fucking good one. And a solid Korean team in North America, I think it's going to shit on people. And it'd be brilliant if they do qualify. And I think it'd be even especially brilliant if they were to sort of take the crown from Cloud9. And it gives a brilliant narrative as well for lazy hacks like me to write about. So I think, you know, for all I've been harsh on Quantic, this could be the fucking smartest move. This could be how you beat the system.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an incredibly smart move, and I think it's one they've planned out for a while, from my understanding, which is good, because a lot of the times, newer teams, when I ran Check 6, we were guilty of it as well. I mean, you know, it's newer management, newer team, things like that. They tend to take something, and they go, hey, we need something as soon as possible. So fuck looking into this anymore. Fuck making sure that, like, who we're actually picking up is, like, actually going to do what we want them to do. We just got to get someone in here now. Yep. I feel like Quantic didn't do that. I feel like they put a little bit of research time into it, actually worked hard, hopefully got some decent fucking contracts to lock these kids down, and did all the proper work ahead of time, which I applaud them for. What I don't applaud them for, though, is just how much money they're going to be spending. I mean, you're talking about, I mean, let's just say, hold on, get another call. I gotta stop it 1 second. But the, let's say what they get, from Rocket is not, I'm just guessing here, not a ton of money. Let's just say not a ton of money. I think this is going to cost them quite a bit. I don't know what they're paying the players by any means, but, just in travel costs or cost to get here, cost to keep them here, things like that. You're talking about a lot of money that they're going to have to get some sponsors coming in the door pretty fucking quick, or else they're just going to run out of money like everyone else.
But I think they're going to do it, and here's to why. Like, right, you got that massive novelty factor now, and if they actually do manage to go out and get some good results very early on, and you know, I mean, look, there's going to be some teams, like we've talked about it, like who only pulled their finger out towards the end of the season. We talked about it last week. Guys like your CLGs, you know, they're going to be looking over their shoulder thinking, fuck, man, we're barely clinging to our goldmine LCS status. You know, like, let's say Curse managed to fucking stay in the league. They're going to have, I mean, they must be looking at, like, a team like that come in to basically qualify and potentially get their spot. And they must be thinking, fuck my life, not Koreans, you know. And I think if they do that and they usurp some established names, I think the sponsors will come because everyone wants a piece of LCS right now.
Yeah, I mean, but I also think it's one of those things where sponsors don't come knocking on your door no matter who the fuck you are, for the most part. I mean, I think you can pick up some of the biggest and best players in the world, and sponsors don't go, hello, Quantic, we'd just like to throw some money at you now. Like, no big deal. You know, whatever you want to do for it, we'll be okay. No, I mean, they've got to fucking pitch people, and they've got to have people actually talking to people and actively creating relationships and making sure that they're not just throwing money down a fucking hole.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's a gamble. It's a gamble, but I think it's a measured gamble. I think, you know, like you say, they've done a bit of homework on it. I think Quantic know that they can't afford another disaster because then people will start saying, man, this management team, like, what the fuck? So they must have really measured it out. It's going to be a lot of money. But one thing I do know as well is, like, generally, like, Koreans take to life in America better than an American would take to life in Korea. You know, if you're the kind of Korean that wants to travel to the States in the first place, you're going to fucking love it out there. You know, like, I have regular conversations with Violet at events. He's just telling me, like, every day is a fucking glorious new adventure. He loves it out there, you know. Learn English in, like, 3 fucking months or some crazy shit because he's Korean. He can just do whatever he wants. So, you know, I think, you know, and I, fingers crossed, man, because Quantic could do a win, right?
Yeah, I really hate to say that I'm rooting for him, but I am. I know a bunch of the guys over there. Most of them I'm pretty cordial with, so I really wish him luck. I think it's a good decision. It's just going to take a lot of work on their part to make sure that they're not just like, well, we're happy being at the top of LCS, we're doing well in LCS, and then just like, well, what else are we supposed to do? Are we supposed to just sit here and like wait for the money to come in? So they have to get to working on that, and they've got to have, you know, people actually working on that. But I think they'll make that a priority. I hope.
So have you got anything else on your mind, Kirk? I think you're going for the hat trick.
Last quick thing, I want to talk about the Azubu.tv layout. Have you seen the new Azubu TV layout?
I don't even want to type Azubu into my fucking search engine in case all the money disappears out my bank account. Those scamming fucks. So what are they doing now?
Well, just go to Azubu.tv, all right? And I'm not even going to say anything about it. Just everyone in the chat.
Oh, look, it's Hearthstone.
Just go to...
Oh, even better. Look, it's the Rainmaker. It's a girl playing Hearthstone with cleavage cam. I fucking love you, Azubu.
No, go to the bottom and hit view more channels and just look at the layout, and you'll see what we're talking about. It looks incredibly familiar. Is really the point.
So where am I at? How far down do I need to go?
Just at the very bottom, it says view more channels, or you can just click on a channel. I think that works too. Go to a channel, look.
Right. Oh. Yeah. I see. View more channels. I've clicked on it.
There we go.
Oh my fucking god! It's Twitch.
I didn't
it's
say
fucking
that.
Fucking Twitch.
I don't know what you're talking about. It doesn't look anything like Twitch. I don't know what you're...
What the fuck? Are they serious?
It looks incredibly familiar.
Are they serious?
I think they're serious.
They can't be... Kurt, they can't be serious. Gareth, have you brought that up?
I've already shown it. I can bring it up again.
You showed him how it looked like Twitch?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yeah, show him again. Put it on now.
It's on now.
Hey, show them. Show them how it looks like Twitch. Guys, it looks like Twitch. So, what the fuck?
Yeah, I mean, here's my thing about it. Number one, I don't really give a shit that they stole the layout. The layout on Twitch, I don't think is fantastic. So I don't know why they would do that. If you go to a channel view, it looks even worse. That the channel view is just looks exactly like Twitch. You know, I'm one of those people, I'm not quite as skeptical about Azubu as some people because... I think in the end, like, I don't really give a shit what they do as long as they pay people. And apparently they've paid people. Like, apparently they're doing a pretty good job paying people. Like, none of their players are crying foul. None of their teams are crying foul.
Where's that money coming from? Like, it would be the first thing. Like, I'm not that anyone in esports would give a fuck.
I don't really care. I don't care where MLG's money's coming from, you know? Like, I don't know. I don't know where their money's coming from, but they're paying people, so I'm not talking. I'm not going to say anything.
But yeah, man, so what do you think? Do you think the Azubu TV is going to be a success then, or what?
You know, the funny thing is I originally thought it wasn't going to be, and I still try to cling to that. Like, but that being said, I think there's a lot of people really looking for an alternative to Twitch. You look at the number one upvoted thing about this theme on our StarCraft, And it's like, I don't give a shit what the layout is as long as it doesn't lag like Twitch. That's the number one fucking response on our StarCraft right now. And I think it was pretty top on our League of Legends, too. So people are looking for an alternative. If, you know, Azubu is actually decent and they get some, you know, some people actually advertising in there, because right now I think they have one advertisement going over and over and over again. Not exactly a fantastic fill rate, but, you know, if they get that, you know, get some advertisers in there and have a decent service, I could see them doing well.
I hope not. They've had more fucking chances. No, serious. They've had enough fucking bites of this cherry. They can fuck off. That's my take on it. Because at the end of the day, if you're a company, right, and you've got a dubious like funding stream to begin with, like I've just felt, you know, like everyone else, I would feel sorry for the people who are owed stuff that's outstanding, you know, like from the old Azubu thing. But like, in terms of setting it up again and starting over, if I was like Riot, I would not want to be associated with them in any way, shape, or form.
The funny thing is, who is owed money from the old Azubu, the quote-unquote old Azubu thing? Like, that's the thing is, I don't know if anyone's owed money from the old Azubu thing. Like, they've...
Not now. No, I don't think so.
Yeah. I mean, they've really... That's the thing is, no matter where they're getting their money from, they're at least abiding by their agreements.
I mean, I don't know what the international law is, but like, right, okay, we all know that it was funded. I mean, it's not even erroneous to say it was funded by fraudulent cash, right? I mean, like, we can say that now. I think.
So if
I don't know what the international law is, but let's say like everyone's like, we got this money, and then the guy gets busted, and then his assets get frozen or whatever the fuck. I mean, like, what happens to the recipients of that money? Have we got a lawyer in the house? Can someone tell me? Because, you know, like, I mean, I don't know. I just think if you're taking dirty esports money, that is going to come back and bite you in the ass. It's great in the short term because it goes in your bank balance, but that's a recipe for disaster for me. And I didn't even say that they're fucked up the second time round. They probably are doing it straight legit, maybe.
maybe.
Yeah, but you know, fuck it. Like, you know, once bitten, twice shy. That's how I live my life. So anyway, Kurt, look, thanks a lot for calling in. We're going to just quickly move into the last segment of the show. Always great to hear from you. As I said, I love you. You're a great guy and with a great voice, and your calls are awesome, and you should have your own show.
See you next week, Richard.
Yeah, no doubt, brother. You take care. Right, so there you go. That was the lovely Kurt, and people were calling him Key, abbreviate Key Hunt to just cunt. Remember, I'm allowed 3 cunts a week. So don't say that, because he's a lovely, lovely chap. And I also just noticed, I wanted to give a shout out, Cruiser the Bruiser, lol celebrity in our Twitch TV chat. Great guy. I love watching his stream as well, like top bloke. So thanks a lot for joining us, Cruiser. Really appreciate that. Right, anyway, we're going to take another break. To all the people who were laughing at me for taking like half an hour to find the link he was talking about, I'm 30, I'm hungover, I haven't got my glasses on. Guys, for fuck's sake, I'm not like you, okay? You're young. You have a life ahead of you. I don't. This is it for me, okay? So just be fucking kind. Be gentle. Anyway, I'll be back in a bit. We're going to take a little break, and then we'll move into the final segment of the show. Don't go anywhere. I know we've got some good calls lined up for you. Death. Oh, we're back. We're into the final third. Yeah, turns out esports journalism does fucking age you people. It does. I'm myopic, like, as well, staring at computer monitors, it fucks your eyes. Look at these big old bad boys, like, and I can't wear them because, you know, I look like Robert De Niro at the end of Casino. It's like just too fucking cringe. Anyway, we're about to have somebody on air who wants to just rant about StarCraft 2 in general and how it's going bad, apparently. So we're going to have him on in a bit. But just before that, I'm going to say cheers. Thanks for tuning in. I'm going to get rid of this hangover the old-fashioned way and just start drinking again. Sam's Wines in King's Heath sold me this San Miguel for 75 pence a bottle. Didn't notice that the fucking sell-by date was scratched off. So here's to you guys. Right, the next caller we got is a chap called Ben. Wants to rant and rave about StarCraft. So, Ben, can you hear me? He's coming.
Yeah, hello.
Hey, Ben, how's it going, brother? You all right?
Yeah, not bad, Ricardo. Not bad, mate. Just had some fucking garlic bread and all that shit. Oh, full as hell, mate. Honestly, it's good stuff. Good stuff.
Right then, Ben. So you want to rant and rave about StarCraft. So
yeah, everyone's like third favorite esport. I know, it's a good game. But I was thinking, I couldn't really think of a topic. I was going through in my mind. I was like, I want to ring in because I think you're pretty and stuff. I wanted a chance to flirt with you. But I want to talk about StarCraft 2, and why isn't it free to play? So this is sort of a rant at Blizzard. And I can't, you know, I've riddled my mind, and I think a lot of people in the scene have, like, why isn't StarCraft 2 at this stage a free to play game? I mean, I think, don't quote me on this, chat people, but I've seen from places that most people buy the game for the campaign, and then a large proportion of them drop off when they've completed it and they've done all they want to do on it. And the multiplayer is sort of not that popular. It is quite obvious that the campaign is more popular.
Yeah, that's true.
Why not just charge for the campaign section? And, you know, the sales must be piss dribbling in at this point. They've made enough sales, right? So update it, free to play. Because one thing I find, you know, when I'm on my internet journeys, that StarCraft 2 doesn't have any sort of relevance as a game. It doesn't pop up often. Yep. When I'm on, like, PC Gamer or whatever, just, you know, checking out game stuff, you see League of Legends or Dota pop up because they're updating stuff, they're changing the game, they're adding stuff, you know, there's news articles, and that's just helping the game be put out in people's eyes. You know, if somebody's surprisingly never heard of Dota or League of Legends, that's a good way of doing it. StarCraft 2 never seems to fucking pop up in these places because they sort of release it and they make a few balance changes and they kind of leave it. I really thought with Heart of the Swarm they were really going to push this, the levels, so you can get up to level 90, you can level the races up.
Yeah.
But a lot of people reached that quite a while ago, and there's no more rewards. You max it, you know, you've got skins and stuff, but they've not updated this. If you turn it to free-to-play, you can add the skins and all that sort of shit, and start using that as a microtransaction. So it's going to bring them in more money, I think. You know, don't quote me, I'm not in the fucking business here, but that makes more sense to me. You've got, you know, something to charge players for, and the fact that it's a free-to-play game brings more people in, it's more relevant. And that bumps up the esports numbers because we're not doing amazing, but we're still pretty good. And something else that I remember, I didn't play StarCraft 1. I only came into enjoying StarCraft a couple of years ago, but StarCraft 1 was really popular in Korea, mainly because you could play it for free. If you go into a PC bang, it was free. So, you know, the Koreans are a bit not as big on StarCraft 2. And one of the reasons why I've heard, you know, this is not my information, but the fact that it's not free, you've got to play, you've got to have the account to play it. And I really think that could bump up some of the enjoyment because when I first started playing StarCraft 2, I was like, this game is shit, like, honestly. And it took me a long time to play the game to get the appreciation to enjoy the esports side of it. And I think when you're looking at 25, 30 quid cost up there, why not just go play Dota or League? It's free, you know, you can enjoy it with your friends and stuff. There's got to be that sort of initiative, somebody to go, oh, I'm going to try that out. But
Ben,
you know,
I totally agree with everything you've said, mate. You're preaching to the fucking choir in that sense. And what I will say is, Blizzard have been so fucking resistant to the free-to-play model for ages. If you were to go back and like look through the archives at interviews when their CEOs and people like that have been asked about free-to-play, yeah, and they are like, no, as far as we're concerned, we make pay for games, you get what you pay for, we like that model. I mean, they're still trying to keep the subscription model alive in World of Warcraft. yeah. You know, and that's dead as fuck. But one of the things that gives hope, like for your vision of the future, and it's a vision I share, and I'd love to see StarCraft go in that direction, is a recent interview with one of the high rankers at Blizzard said that they were receptive to free-to-play. Like, fucking finally, you know, like 2-3 years after everyone else.
It was acknowledged, finally, sort of, as
an option. They said that it was something they were going to take a long, hard look at in relation to World of Warcraft. Now, I think we can say certainly, World of Warcraft is going to go free to play at some point in the not too distant future. I think it has to. They're in a declining spiral, and they've got a big update coming out, which I think is going to be the last attempt to boost subscriptions, milk some subscription money. And then I think it's going to go free to play. That'll be the next project for them. And if World of Warcraft, when it's free to play, is successful, which it could be, they've dumbed it down. It's a really old game, but it's still one of the best MMOs.
Yeah,
it's still very easy to fuck up an MMO, as we saw with even a great company like BioWare with fucking Knights of the Old Republic, which was fucking dog shit.
Yeah,
and a heartbreaker for all Star Wars enthusiasts. But I think if World of Warcraft gets a shot in the arm, I think then they might say, yeah, we can do it with StarCraft. But unfortunately, I think we're 3-4 years away from that.
Yeah, definitely. I think if that ever kicks in, it's going to be too late. It needs to be, well, ideally, as soon as possible, because like I was saying, relevance is the success of a lot of esports. And if you're not changing the game and you're making balance changes that aren't even like a big thing, you're not adding units or skins or anything, nobody's going to be talking about you. Like, it's the only thing that provides news for StarCraft really is the esports scene itself. And if that's going down, then, where is their relevance going to be coming from?
Yeah. I mean, just to pick your brains, because obviously you've talked about your own experience. You didn't like StarCraft. You played it. You got into it. What do you play now? Like, have you moved on to other free-to-play games?
I've tried League of Legends. I've tried Dota. And it's that I'm with games, I'm like, if I get over the first milestone of learning the game, I kind of get into it. With those two games, I've not found an interest yet. I play StarCraft. I go through segments because I get really bad game rage and I end up throwing shit about my room and I say to myself, well, I'm not going to play this game for 2 months now because my family's going to start getting annoyed because there's
My PC.
There's many times I have to pretend that I was mucking about on Skype or whatever because I'm punching stuff and going mad. It's straight embarrassing. There's nothing else about it. I'm sweating about it. So StarCraft, what got me into it, I think, was I'm kind of competitive, but I like beating myself. I like Trap Mania because I going around in a circle until I can get the fastest time possible. And with StarCraft, it was all about challenging myself to press the buttons in the right order and guess, and the guessing turned to learning, and then I sort of got a grasp and I tried to beat it in that sense. And I think what attracts me to StarCraft, and I think attracts a lot of people that have not even discovered the game yet, is the difficulty of it. You can get a certain... It's the weird thing is where the difficulty pushes most people away, but I think it also attracts a certain type of person. Mm. I think the majority of the people that are still active in the game now are attracted to that, okay, right, I'm going to beat this, and...
What I will add to that as well is, of course, because it's a 1v1 game, and people are saying... In the games industry, that 1v1 games are dying. Like which it seems strange to me because the biggest scourge and the most unenjoyable aspect of League of Legends are my teammates. Always.
Something has put me off those games.
Yeah, it's not even the opposition. Because if they're just better than me, fuck it, they're better than me, deal with it. But it's my teammates. having to rely on 4 other retards to fucking... push this boulder up a hill for 1 hour, and then at the end of it, what do I get? Like, if you lose, you don't even unlock an achievement. You can't even sit there and say, oh, well, at least I've played 100 games with Nautilus now, and I've got a badge on my profile. No, you just wasted an hour of your life with 4 fucking retards for company, and they fucked you over, and, fuck it. That's it. So I don't understand why, 1v1 games are becoming less popular, because... at least you're in absolute control. It's about your mastery of the game.
And I'm socially retarded. I have literally zero friends, and I spend my entire time sort of wallowing in my own shit, basically. So I don't really have many people to play games with. So 1v1 for me, yeah, great. You know, don't have to deal with anyone, don't have to talk to anyone, and helps you sort of realize that, you know, being antisocial is good. But like 1v1 games, I mean, like you talked about Reborn earlier, worst fucking name for a game of all time. I mean, that's meant to be 1v1, right? Like the main aspect.
Well,
of it,
yeah, I presume so, because you know, that's what James, when we've had brief conversations about it, and usually we talk about how the quest for funding's going. But yeah, it's basically what he considers the ultimate FPS. So for him, it would be a Quake successor, which of course is.
Yeah, I must admit, I really like the sound of the project. Quake was like one of the first esports I like started watching. Was like, oh, this is interesting. I'm going to watch it and put some time into watching it. So I kind of, because Counter Strike.
Yeah.
did you lose me then, or?
No. I'm waiting for it, because I heard the two words that are going to make me fucking start sweating: Counter-Strike.
So. Counter-Strike. I enjoy it. I played COD 4 a lot, and you know, pro mod and all that stuff. I was shit at it, but that was my first game I tried to get good at, right?
Yeah.
And that was team-based, but I could never sit down and really watch it. I never enjoyed watching a LAN, and I think it's to do with the spectating experience that sort of ruined it for me. And I struggle with Counter-Strike in that same... I'm really bad at, like, the way... I'm wording this bad. I don't like the fact that they miss a lot of the action. And the thing I like about 1v1 games is that you can stay on one person and you always get to see, like, the receiving end of the action, like, what he's doing to the other person and whatnot. I don't know why I'm explaining this.
I know exactly what you're saying. Like, why 1v1, again, it's always going to be a superior spectator experience.
So I want that back for something other than StarCraft, because FPS is something I got started off with and I really enjoy it, and it is a big genre still.
So would you back the Reborn project then? Would you be, you know, balls deep in that?
It's mainly if I can be bothered to put my like debit card information into like setting an account up on Kickstarter, really. But no, honestly, I need to see more, and obviously they've got to make more if they get the funding and stuff. Because I know what excites me about Reborn. I know I came on to talk about StarCraft, but Reborn's more interesting. What interests me about Reborn is the fact that James has said that they're focusing on, like, out of everything else, is the movement and the engine. They've switched engine 3 times because they've got some guy that's going to be working for them for like a year for no money. I watched his grilled thing. Shout out to Thor in there. Great work. And I kind of think out of all developers, James is going to be going in with not an esports focus. That's obviously going to be in there. Don't get me wrong. But I think, first and foremost, it is going to be the game mechanics that are prioritized, and esport game mechanics, or, you know, competitive game mechanics is probably a better way to say it, because I think with FPS, and this is something when I play Counter-Strike, I don't enjoy it much, is that Counter-Strike is 90% aim and then like 10% strategy and choosing where you go, right? With Quake, it was like this massive shit, like, well, you've got to be great at movement. You've got to, you know the maps really well. And then you've got to be sick at aiming. And there was a lot of players. I'm not going to say names because I'm not an expert. I don't remember much from it. But what I gather from it is there's a lot of people that weren't the best aimers. They weren't the best with all the weapons. But if they were good at one of the elements of it, it had enough depth for you to be able to play that into your skill and be good, because it had that depth. So I'm hoping when Reborn hits, it's going to have depth, you know, the movement is going to be good, and I hope that they focus on these the mechanics in more depth than, so I keep saying the word fucking depth, Jesus Christ.
No, but you're right, you're on the money. I think James is the guy who it's his strong point for me as a person is always being able to sort of cut through the bullshit and just get to the simple answer. And, you know, why haven't a lot of FPS games been successful? I think you're right. It's the mechanics. It's always been the mechanics. It's always been the engine. You know, people want consistency. So if I do something, I want it to have the same outcome every time, because that learned muscle memory, you know, that's what makes a competitive player. So I don't want random elements like Counter-Strike Source had, for example. You know, well, very fucking random elements, I should say. And indeed CSGO as well, to a certain degree.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think James... will have a very good handle on the mechanics. For me right now, it's can he reinvent the wheel? Because I'm an old fart, right? But I mean, I don't know how old you are, Ben. I'm guessing early 20s, 19?
8.
Nah, come on. How old really?
Yeah, 19, man. Yeah, 19.
All right, there you go, right? I remember what it was like to be young and cool. I remember. that's how I could identify you straight away in that age bracket. Cool, but... Yeah, it's true. Wallowing in your own shit is cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Don't worry about it. You're in good company. So I remember what it was like back then. But like, you know, you're still really an older gamer now. I mean, like, you know, you're not like old like I'm old, but you're an older gamer. You've brought
yeah,
you've
fucking
been brought
hell,
up...
I'm not anywhere near you. Jesus.
No. But you will be one day, and you'll have all the problems that go with it. But the baldness, the you know, all of that. You've got to all look forward to, and that's great. But the thing is, in terms of gaming. You know, you've played lots of games. You've played new genres, emerging genres. Now, games developers for me these days aren't trying to make new genres. They're trying to basically make the next Call of Duty, the next Grand Theft Auto, an existing idea that will make them a lot of money. And it's become very fucking stale, very fucking stagnant. And the problem that James is facing, that the Reborn Project is facing, is that it is just going to be Quake. Perfected. So for me, the challenge that he faces is to create something so new about it that a new gamer, like somebody who thinks that FPS started with fucking Battlefield, or you know, RTS started with StarCraft, you know, doesn't know about the rich history of games, never even heard of Carrier Command on the Spectrum from 1988-89, developed by Mike Singleton, which was the first ever real-time strategy game. It's often wrongly attributed to Dune 2 by Westwood Studios, who of course made Command and Conquer. But you know, these people aren't going to know about that. And they're going to want the things they're familiar with. And let's be honest, new games have a lot of fucking bells and whistles these days. You know, they've got loads. It's all shiny and it's all sparkly and shit. A new kid couldn't pick up something as simple as Quake today and be thrilled with it in the same way that we would be. So that, for me, is the challenge Reborn faces. I've got no doubt that mechanically it'll be awesome. I just think the audience that's out there, mechanics ain't going to be enough.
It's true. But then, you know, this falls back to it, the whole thing of, like, if it's not going to be, like, one of these AAA titles that with the bells and whistles, going the free-to-play route with a community backing it is the next best thing, isn't it? Because if you're going to attract attention, hey, look, free shit, come get it. So, I'll leave it to another person.
We're going to end the show, Ben. You've had the last word, brother.
Oh, what? Really? Oh,
yeah,
man.
It's 10 o'clock. That's it. I've done my 2 hours. I've done my community service. I can go and get arseholed. But I'll tell you what, Ben, I really liked your call. I like the cut of your jib, and you're going to be on our approved callers list. So don't delete the Skype at all, and hopefully you'll call in next week or another week with some good ideas, man.
Well, I'm not going to be doing anything. So,
neither am I, brother. Don't worry about that. Nothing going on. But thanks a lot for your call and take care.
All right, man. Cheers. Thanks.
All the best. So there you go, Ben, talking about the nature of StarCraft 2, and then a nice little diversion into Reborn. Not enough people talk about that, I don't think. Anyway, where are we going to end the show? What's going to be the final thought? Well, I thought it was interesting. We mentioned, I think it was last week or maybe the week before, we talked about that Iranian League of Legends thing about how they banned female characters from the tournament, but were going to overturn maybe Annie because she wasn't sexualized and stuff. And there was a response on the WCG Iran Facebook page that because what had got ignored, we were all laughing about, oh, you've banned Katarina and her massive boobs. So we all ignored the fact that actual women were banned from competing in the tournament, which I can understand why, because I guess when you're wearing a fucking burqa, your peripheral vision's obscured anyway. So... But they were banned from the tournament. Women were banned from the tournament. And the guy on Facebook actually said, women have always been banned from all WCG games. He said it's normal. He goes, not just in Iran, the world over. Women, when was the last time you saw a woman competing in these games? So I've been trying to get in touch with WCG for an official statement about it, because I've never heard a bigger load of bullshit in my life. I cannot imagine any gaming organization would ban women from their competition, allowing them to enter. It seems insane. So you can go and check this out for yourself, by the way. But I think where we're going to end is, I'll just get my producer here. I'm going to give you a little link, Gareth. I'd like you to bring this up on screen if you can. Now, I do... on your other Skype account. How can I do that?
Just a normal chat, you can.
No, I can't.
I promise you can.
Okay, right. So that one. Is that it? Have you got it? Yeah?
That is that chat I've just messaged you on.
Right. Okay, cool. Right, fuck, man. What a great outro this is.
It's perfect.
Not at all awkward. Yeah, but right, there you go. Now, I do this for the love of the community. I do it for you guys. I love you guys so very much, and you've given me a shot in the arm and keeping me going in esports when I'm old enough to definitely get out. And someone today came into the chat and said, has anyone else noticed that Richard Lewis looks like this animal? Now, guys, are you fucking serious? Are you serious? Is this what it has come to? Really? That I am the blobfish? I don't know. I don't know what to make of it. This is why we can't have nice things, guys. Because look at that. Look at the fucking state of that. It's the nose. Yeah, I know. Well, some of us used to box. And some of us weren't very good. Anyway, I think that's a fitting note to end the show on. I actually banned the guy who did that. Fuck that guy. He's right, but fuck him. So anyway, it's been a great show. I've loved it. I love doing every bit of this show. We've had some great callers. We'll be back on the regular day, back on Wednesday, 8 o'clock. If you want to get your call in early and you want to be guaranteed a slot, add Trash Talk TV to your Skype now. The VOD is going to be instantly uploaded. I recommend you tell all your friends about it, because I think we can make this show something beautiful as the blobfish. Anyway, thanks a lot to all the callers. Thanks a lot to all the viewers. Have a nice evening. Peace out.